everybody. We had a record 133,000 tests to 8pm yesterday, which is a great result. We encourage people to keep coming forward to get tested to make sure we're scooping up all the cases that are out there in the community. There were 283 cases of community transmission, with at least 64 of them infectious for that time in the community. Horribly, we had one death overnight, a woman in her 90s who was in palliative care. She was unvaccinated, but our deepest heartfelt condolences to her loved ones. All deaths are horrible during this time, and again, we extend our deepest sympathy to her loved ones at this difficult time. The epicentre of the virus in New South Wales and Sydney still remains the Canterbury-Bankstown local government area. We are seeing some stabilisation in other local government areas, but that local government area is proving to demonstrate the virus is still circulating, and we also ask people in those adjoining local or suburbs, I should say, in those adjoining suburbs to the Canterbury-Bankstown local government area to especially be on high alert. That remains the greatest challenge for us, and it's where the compliance, the police are focusing their efforts as well to make sure people are doing the right thing. So we please ask everybody in that local government area to be especially careful not to leave home unless you absolutely have to. And of course, we're asking people not to go into those areas unless it's absolutely essential. You should not be going anywhere near those local government areas if you live outside those communities. Please know that is proving to be an ongoing threat. Unfortunately, somebody from Newcastle went to Tamworth, and there's a number of exposure sites in Tamworth. There aren't any cases there yet, but we do know the person went from Newcastle to Tamworth and visited a number of locations. So as a precaution, the health experts have recommended that we lock down Tamworth for 1 week, starting from 5 o'clock today. I understand there's already been discussions with community leaders and people on the ground in that area. So there aren't any cases yet, but there have been a number of confirmed exposure sites because somebody left Newcastle and went to Tamworth who was infected at the time. There's also a call out for everybody in and around the Byron community to come forward and get tested. So the Northern Rivers community is on high alert at this stage. There won't be any further action taken. But I understand, and Dr. Chant will elaborate, that there is a case there, someone who's been mobile, and of course health are still determining the extent of that mobility and where they went. So we are calling out everybody in Byron in the Northern Rivers community has any symptoms to come forward and get tested, and the health experts are watching that community very closely. Today is a positive day for HSC students in those local government areas of concern. We're looking forward to welcoming them all to Qdos Bank Arena today and having them vaccinated. We know how key the vaccination is, not just to obviously preventing people from going into hospital, but from reducing the spread. And we're especially pleased that we're giving HSC students the opportunity to safely sit their exams, to make sure they're vaccinated by the time their exams roll round. And I want to thank all those students who've already registered, those that are turning up, and we hope to see thousands vaccinated during the course of this week. And of course, from next week, Qdos Bank Arena will open up into a broader mass vaccination hub, joining the number of mass vaccination hubs throughout Greater Sydney and New South Wales. Can I also welcome today in particular Dr. Richard Totro, who is the manager of the ICU unit at RPA. He deals with COVID patients on a daily basis, and we thought it opportune for him to discuss what he sees and what he's recommending to the great citizens of our state in relation to dealing with COVID. So a big welcome to Dr. Richard, and what we'll do is obviously after Dr. Richard speaks, we'll ask the media to provide him with any questions so that he can leave and get back to his important work, with all due respect to everybody here. So I'll now get Dr. Chant to provide her update, and then we'll ask Dr. Richard Totro to say a few words.
Thank you very much, Premier. So there were 283 locally acquired cases of COVID and a record number of tests, 133,840. In terms of the, there are currently 349 COVID cases admitted to hospital, with 67 in intensive care and 27 of whom require ventilation. In terms of the areas we are most concerned about, we're most concerned about the Canterbury-Bankstown area, and also we're seeing stabilisation in Fairfield, but still a reasonably high case levels in Fairfield, Liverpool, Blacktown and Penrith. Particularly that eastern area where we took that action yesterday to introduce further restrictions. In terms of the Tamworth lockdown provisions, I'll just disclose that a young lady was exposed to COVID in Newcastle. She then travelled to Tamworth on the evening of the 4th, arriving in Tamworth on the 5th. She attended a number of venues, and I'll read those out, and anyone who's been at these venues is considered a close contact and must get tested and isolate for 14 days. And we've also got a number of casual contact venues. So in terms of the venues where we're requiring people to immediately isolate and get tested, and you're going to have to stay in that isolation for 14 days, it's the Inland Cafe Tamworth on Thursday the 5th of August from 9:15 to 10 a.m. The Tudor Hotel Tamworth on Thursday the 5th of August from 11 a.m. to 11:40 a.m. And the Habesha Ethiopian Restaurant, The Junction, at any time on Friday the 31st of July to Thursday the 5th of August. And the Mr. Rice Takeaway Cook's Hill on Wednesday the 4th of August from 3 p.m. to 3:20 p.m. And anyone who attended the following venues on the specified dates and times are casual contacts and must get tested and isolate until a negative test result is received. And that is the Gloria Jean's Tamworth on Thursday the 5th of August, 9:15 to 9:20 a.m. The Super Vape Store in Tamworth on Thursday the 5th of August from 10:55 to 11:05. And the Ampole Roadhouse on Thursday the 5th of August from 12:25 to 12:30. She then returned to Newcastle on the 5th of August, and hence why there are no additional exposure venues from that time. The Premier mentioned that we have been alerted overnight to a gentleman in his 50s who is staying in the Byron area. Investigations are underway to determine his source of infection. We understand he did travel from Sydney earlier in towards the end of July. He is currently being re-interviewed, and we are also arranging urgent testing of his two household contacts. And once we have more information, we'll be alerting to the community in terms of any venues that he's checked into. At the moment, we don't have any venues that he's checked in using his QR codes at this time. Thank you.
Hello. There's a lot of focus about cases and total case numbers in the state. The thing about the case numbers is that eventually those cases funnel into the ICU. ICUs across the state are a relatively limited resource. They're usually quite full. And the ICUs are really the centre of hospitals. It allows us to do things like heart surgery, complex obstetrics. It allows us to look after patients who've had multiple trauma. It allows us to do leukemia treatments. A whole variety of things need access to the intensive care unit. This disease is a disease where a small number of people who get sick end up in the intensive care unit. And they stay in the ICU quite a long time. Normally, patients in the ICU are there for 3-4 days on average. Patients who have COVID, who end up on ventilators, on the breathing machine, on life support, stay in ICU from the UK data something like 3 weeks. If you're in the ICU, you're on life support and you're on dialysis, you stay in the ICU somewhere around 5 weeks. So you can see how a unit which is designed to have patients coming through at high numbers, lots of throughput, all of a sudden these patients come in, they slow the flow down, they slow everything down. It makes the unit slowly fill up. We've got access to ICUs at the moment in Sydney, lots of room. ICUs are a combination of a very complicated bed, lots of infrastructure, machines. But much more importantly than that is ICUs are built around intensive care, and the intensive carers in our ICUs are the nurses. Our nurses are absolutely vital to providing the technical skills of looking after the machines, are vital to looking after the patients and recognising when they're getting sick, when they're getting better. and also to providing compassionate care to the patients when they're having, you know, the worst time of their lives, and the patients' families. COVID has really changed how we have to deal with families. We can't do face-to-face meetings. We have to do this digitally, and it really adds an extra layer of complexity. Looking after COVID patients is very hard work. It's really demanding. You're in layers of PPE, which is hot. Particularly for the nurses, it's difficult work. It's physical work. For the medical staff, if you're doing procedures, if you're doing operations on these patients, you've got the PPE and then sterile equipment over the top of that. It can be very difficult work. And these are really sick patients. So what we want to do is take these patients who are really sick and stop having them. We want to stop people getting sick and ending up in ICU. And there's really good evidence from all over the world that the vaccinations that we have available to us stop people, once they're vaccinated, stop people needing to come into hospital. Almost all the hospitalisation goes away. Almost all the need for ICU goes away. And almost all the death goes away once people have been vaccinated properly. And that's what we want to see. You take this disease, which in older people, 10-20% of people end up in ICU, and you make it a much more mild disease. A disease that can be managed as outpatients, it can be managed with telehealth and so on, rather than burdening the hospitals, overrunning hospitals. And we know from having looked around the world that when hospitals are overburdened, when they're running at over capacity, more people would die, more people die than would have otherwise.
They regret not getting vaccinated?
Unfortunately, once patients come to my ICU, most of them are too sick to be talking to us. They're on ventilators, they're feeling really sick, and I personally haven't heard that. I'm aware of other people around who've been told that, yes.
Dr. Are you worried about the capacity of our current hospital system and the ICU system more broadly? Are you worried about that coping with the spread of this outbreak?
At the moment, the hospital system is responding really well. Everyone is pulling together. There are reconfigurations and a whole pile of stuff being done to help us cope. So at the moment, we're responding really well.
Doctor, how many ICU beds does a regional hospital typically have? How many sick COVID patients can they handle before they need to start transferring to a city hospital, patients away from their families and that sort of thing?
Most regional ICUs are smaller than big hospital ICUs, but it's not so much the number of beds, it's the amount of staff. And at the moment, the regional hospitals are well staffed, they're running okay.
Dr. Yeah. Todorow, how many cases a day could New South Wales withstand at the moment before the ICU is under significant stress and we see more lives lost than should be?
I actually don't know the answer to that. I'd have to turn to our public health experts to give me advice on that.
Do you think at 200 to 300 cases a day, what you're seeing at the moment, until November, where there's 80% double dose, the ICU systems could manage, or are you concerned about keeping 200 to 300 cases a day until that period?
We've been running at about 200 to 300 cases a day for a little while, and the ICUs are managing well. Yeah.
Doctor, this might be a question more suited to Dr. Chart, but perhaps you know the answer. You mentioned reconfigurations to make sure that the hospital system is on top of things. Are COVID-positive patients in hospital being transferred from Sydney hospitals like yours to other hospitals, potentially Wollongong?
Not that I'm aware of.
Dr. Chart, sorry.
Fine. There'll be clinical decisions about patients moving wherever is clinically appropriate to do based on ICU availability. Clearly, a large number of the southwestern Sydney communities live very close to Wollongong, so whilst it sounds distant, there is actually quite connectivity. So I wouldn't rule out anything. What we're more committed to is making sure that people have access to the best care. And can I just also acknowledge that the intensive care that is provided in the Australian context is one of the best in the world. But I think that you would actually say the key message is get vaccinated. We do not want to see anyone in ICU, and we have the tools to prevent you going to ICU, and that's getting vaccinated. And I don't think we've seen anyone who's had the two doses of vaccine in ICU. And I think it's really critical for people to go out and get vaccinated. Can I also just go back to my call out about Byron? I should have also mentioned that we do need to get testing numbers in that Byron community up, so anyone with signs and symptoms. Unfortunately, this gentleman was infectious in the community for a while. He had symptoms for several days, so we are quite concerned, and we do want to see those testing numbers increase in that area, and we'll be monitoring that closely.
Sorry, before I hand back to Dr. Todorow, can I also make this point, that it's not so much when it comes to intensive care units and the number of patients in there, it's not so much the number of cases we have, it's the number of cases we have that aren't vaccinated. Because vaccination is keeping people out of ICU, it's keeping people out of hospital. So it's not the total number of cases you need to look at to predict what's going to happen in intensive care. It's the total number of cases that aren't vaccinated, which will give you an indication of what's in ICU. And as Dr. Totterow will stress, it's a relief to us that both vaccines are holding up really well. Both vaccines are demonstrating keeping people out of hospital, keeping people out of harm's way, and also reducing the spread. And that's why, to our outstanding health teams across the hospital network, who are dealing with COVID patients every day, who see the pain and suffering that we don't see, their families do, and the staff do, what we can do to support them is to make sure we get vaccinated.
Do you agree, though, Premier, 50%...
For Dr. Totterow first.
Come on, mate.
Dr. Totterow first. Yeah. Then he can go to work.
Thank you. Other jurisdictions looking at overseas, is there anything comparable? Like Quebec was mentioned yesterday, something that's comparable to New South Wales. Are there other jurisdictions you look at overseas where you're modelling how your hospitals can cope and how your ICU wards can cope?
New South Wales is pretty lucky. We've got controlled numbers at the moment and very different to what we've seen in the US, the UK, through Europe. So we can look at their numbers for how many people need to be in ICU and how many people need, how long they're going to be with us. But, you know, for us, the really striking thing is that we haven't seen anyone who's had two vaccines, both their vaccines, come to the ICU and need to be with us. Nobody on ventilators with two vaccines, nobody on ECMO, nobody in the ICU needing after having had two vaccines. And if people get themselves vaccinated, they're helping themselves, because you'll stop yourself getting sick. You're going to stop the people around you, your family, your loved ones, the people that you live with and work with, from getting sick, because they won't get it from you because you're not going to get it. And you're going to help the whole community, because, one, the higher the vaccination rates we have, the less people there are getting sick. And two, then we can go back to having the sort of, you know, back to our lives that we had before. So getting everybody vaccinated, older people, young people, absolutely have to go out and get vaccinated. That's a really important thing from us.